right, what do we got for mailbag this week?
Yeah, so this one is from @ArtNunnyMiss.
Hey, Katie and Matt, this is Teresa in Long Beach, California, and I want to know what would render that stimulus check uncashable. For example, if I were to write next to the Ronald J. Chump signature, put a comma, and underneath that, fake president, is that okay? What if I were to write on there, lock him up, with an arrow pointing to the Ronald J. Chump signature? How's that? What if I were to draw, like, sad little inadequate toadstools that were crying with their tiny little hands? Can I do that and still cash the check?
I like that.
Yeah, I think it would be great if people just sent in the pictures that they drew on those checks to see what didn't get cashed. I mean, I think they'd probably be pretty liberal about almost anything you did on those checks, as long as they're endorsed properly. So if you wanted to face those checks, you want to risk that $1,200, we're obviously not gonna compensate you for that, but we'd love to see what work you
your paper
do.
Trail, yeah.
So give it a shot and let us know how it works.
Maybe how about we'll give them a free Useful Idiot shirt.
We can do that.
Which is worth so much more than $1,200.
It is. What do we got next, then?
This is from @RobRousseau.
Hello, Katie and Matt and the Useful Idiots podcast. Rob Rousseau here. And I've got a question for you, too. And here's my question. Would a Joe Biden administration be better than a Donald Trump administration from a foreign policy standpoint? I know when Trump was running in 2016, that was one area where it seemed like he might be better. Trump's a dumb guy, but he's at least smart enough in at that time to understand that these wars, these forever wars, are like very, very unpopular. And he kind of got to the Hillary campaign's left on that issue. But their actual result hasn't really been a positive thing at all for foreign policy. Some of the good things that the Obama administration had done, like normalizing relations with Iran and Cuba, have been kind of thrown in the garbage. It's been a lot more confrontational in a lot of areas. So that's what I'm wondering. Suppose Joe Biden does manage to win this election. How is a Joe Biden administration going to be different from a Donald Trump administration from a foreign policy perspective?
He has a great podcast, by the way, that people should listen to.
Oh, really? Okay, excellent. No. So what I think about Trump and foreign policy is that, like, on enormous ranges of things, he's like a disaster, because there are lots of areas where you do want to have pretty close international cooperation about things, and we're even seeing this a little bit with the coronavirus response. You know, the Paris Accord, environmental treaties, all that stuff is terrible. You know, he's bad on that stuff. He hasn't really been great on lessening the amount of violence, because he did step up the amount of drone bombings and he's massively escalated the military budget. But there is one thing about Trump that I still think is true, which is that politically he doesn't have an appetite for war. And whether that's because he doesn't want to have generals living in his White House, in his Oval Office all day long, or he realizes that he's not good at being a commander in chief, or whatever it is, in opposition to a lot of presidents who, dating back to the days of Kennedy, have always thought that this is how presidents make their legacies, is at war. It's been kind of noticeable that Trump hasn't had a full blown shooting war in office. So that might be the one thing that I would say is a positive about him, is that he seems to have a reluctance, for whatever reason, it might not even be a positive reason.
Sure, right, yeah.
To go to war.
I mean, it's interesting. I'm glad that Rob, by the way, his I said he had a podcast. I didn't mention the name, which makes it not as useful. It's 49th Parallel. But I think that what Rob brought up, which is useful, is, or helpful to remember, is the stuff like Iran and Cuba. And I'm thinking of the sanctions, right, which are murderous. I mean, sanctions are kill people. Not in the same instant way that drones do, but they do block food and medicine from getting into countries. And especially now with the coronavirus, for instance, in Iran, they're just suffering much more than they would otherwise. Of course, he did kill Soleimani. There is something like about Trump that I feel like 90% sure that he would be not as bad on certain things, but then there's that 10% that he could just blow up the entire world.
Well, yeah, I don't know about that. The last other series of administrations heading into Trump massively escalated our presence, military presence all over the world. You know, numerous deployments in the Middle East were active military operations in, what, 8 different countries leading into right. Trump's first year. So it's not good either way. I don't think Trump is good in almost any level because he doesn't really believe in international cooperation on most right. things. I just think that he has a personal thing about war that is yeah. probably, you know, beneficial.
And in the case of like North Korea, you know, it is weird again. And Syria, we've seen this time and time again, where the Dems kind of like don't know how to get out, criticize Trump from the left on these issues. I even was privy to seeing a bunch of people who identify as progressive and liberals really upset about Trump's like peace talks with Kim Jong-un, which sure, they were like opportunistic and not that substantive, but I just think that's better than ratcheting things up with North Korea. And people were upset. They thought that he'd be able to run on that issue.
Again, our posture automatically towards almost every country that disagrees with us about anything dating back decades is just pure belligerence. And that hasn't actually always been the case with this administration, but they've been nuts about right. other things.
They have been nuts, yeah.
It's an interesting question. What do we got next, Dan?
This is from @reciprocalhokey.
Hi, Matt and Katie. This is Scott Chase from Chapel Hill, North Carolina. At what point in this Trump bungled response, leading to horrific infection rates and American deaths from COVID-19, will the United States be considered by the rest of the modern world as a national security risk, worthy of a mitigation strategy?
I think the United States has been a security risk for the rest of the world long before this. I mean, we have injected most of the weapons around the world. We built most of them. We've created destabilizing situations on virtually every continent. We've involved ourselves in dozens of different covert and overt operations to try to overthrow elections. We create most of the world's waste. Well, actually, that's probably not true anymore, but in terms of creating industrial waste, we're still a major offender on that score. We have defied UN guidelines about state-sponsored terrorism. You know, if you just look at in terms of the response to the coronavirus, we were slow, but it wasn't like we were so far out of step compared to every other country. Yeah, I think this is less of a Trump thing than just the United States is crazy generally, and it's in the way that it looks at its relations with other countries.
But didn't Trump disband certain bodies that are like good at this stuff?
I'm less about the blaming for having a late response to an unprecedented situation than, for instance, urging people on the streets
yeah,
after
sure.
we already know how bad it is. Like, that's a totally different level of,
right.
of whatever, you know. Maybe one more, Dan, if we could.
All right, I got one here. This is from @dpriest.
Hey, Matt and Katie. This is Darren Priest. I have a question for your podcast. It's basically, will Michael Lewis's book about this bailout be good and worth reading? Or after The Big Short and the last couple, should I just give up on him? There's nothing to be learned from Wall Street anymore.
Wow, that's a harsh question. I like The Big Short. I'm a big fan of Michael Lewis. I thought Liar's Poker was one of the great books about Wall Street, just because it was super accessible and allowed people who didn't really know anything about the subject to really get into it. It was a funny book. The Big Short also, it's just really smart marketing. It like took a very difficult subject and it found a way into it. Let's say let's find a bunch of people who correctly bet against the crisis and let's tell the story through their eyes. And, you know, it's not fulminating against the evils of Wall Street, which is maybe what you want to hear, but it does tell you a lot about how all that stuff worked. So if Michael Lewis ends up doing a story about a book about this bailout, you know, I think it would be for sure something that would be educational. Do I do I love all of his books? No, but I mean, I think a lot of them are terrific.
Sure. I haven't read them. I've only seen the movies.
Did you watch Moneyball?
No, I only watched the Adam McKay one.
Did you see The Blind Side?
With Sandra Bullock?
Yes.
That was him?
Yes.
No, I mean, yes. I wish I could unsee it, though.
Really? Yeah, that was a difficult watch.
Yeah.
But I will say about Michael Lewis, and it's interesting because he and I have covered a lot of the same stuff over the years, but he has such a better way of taking a difficult subject and reducing it into a cinematic pitch for a way that's not only is it great for him financially, but it's also a way, good for translating it for big audiences.
I don't blame him for The Blind Side, because I'm sure that book was better.
Well, the book was really about, he's clearly a sports fan, and the book was really about like left tackles and why they're important, which is kind of strange. So,
well, I mean, it's kind of obvious to someone like me who's fond
right,
of left
yes.
tackles.
Who are your top 8 left tackle favorites over the years?
Joe Montana.
Joe Montana?
You know what? Excellent. I don't even know if I can name 8 football players. Let me try. Joe Montana, Tebow.
Tebow was a football player. That's true.
Okay, Joe Montana, Tebow, Colin Kaepernick.
Yes. There's a guy, won a bunch of Super Bowls. He's now in Tampa.
Oh,
ring a bell.
Brady.
There you go. All right.
Brady. Did Bo Jackson play football? He played a lot of sports. Yes.
He also played baseball. That's 5.
Yeah. Okay, I need 3 more. Didn't O.J. Simpson play
He did
football?
Play football. Very good. Okay. Yes.
So yeah. What am I up to, 6? I need 2 more. Okay.
This is pretty impressive. It's pretty hard to live in America and not know 8 football players.
All right. I only need 2 more. Hold on. I got to be able to come up with a couple more. Did any of them date famous models or something? Tom Brady
did, yes.
Did Belichick ever play?
At your school, he did, actually.
Oh, okay. There you go. So that's my 7th. I'm going to have to come back next week with like a book report on football players.
All right. Well, you know, we could spend all day trying to go through all the football players that Katie doesn't know about.
Maybe next episode I'll get to 10.
Yeah, we'll see if you can get to 10 next episode.